Witnesses to this marriage as we have gathered together in faithfulness to God and to this dear couple. Let's pray as we get started today. Our Father in heaven, you are holy. You are on your throne. You have chosen this day to reach down to us in this moment and meet us here with your presence as we seek to honor you during this time. I ask that you would bless this wedding day, that you would bless this time. We thank you that you have brought us together today, and we desire to honor you and glorify you in this place. I pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. Well, we're finally here. And it's exciting, and I'm just like, wow. I'm excited for you guys. And look, just look around. Make sure you look at all these people. Remember, take it in, savor this moment. It'll be hard for you to remember, but it's okay. This is your wedding day, and I can tell you, I am excited, as I already did. I'm excited for you as you begin this adventure together today. I want to simply go over a few reflections with you on marriage. As I was thinking about this and I was preparing for this time where we'd be together, and I came up with, I think I actually talked to you guys a little bit about this already, three C's. You could call it the CCC, except for it's not the Civilian Conservation Corps. You know, all those places where you go rattlesnake hunting and see those signs up and stuff. So. But the three C's, and marriage is about Christ, first C, about communication, second C, and community. So naturally, as Christ followers, Christ is the central, and he's the all-encompassing person of our lives individually and as and together. He is in and he works through everything that we are and do. And it is important to remember that Christ is the center and the foundation of your relationship. Just like a good house is built on a solid foundation, a good marriage is based on a solid foundation of Jesus Christ. I was, one day I was over at my father-in-law's, and he had gotten a scope. one of those really long, like the ones you set on the table or on a tripod. You look way far out. And I was trying to look through it, and it was pretty powerful. I was trying to actually see North Street building from their house. And it's kind of hard because you just hit the foundation, you hit it with your hand, and because it's so focused out, it would just move the scope around like crazy. And the same way when you're hunting, you're looking through the scope and you're not on a very good foundation if you're not strong in your arms, you know, it moves around and you miss what you're aiming for. So you need a good foundation. I needed a good foundation when I was looking through that scope so that my view didn't get off balance or I'd end up aiming at the wrong thing. Jesus is our firm foundation so that we can keep a proper view of life and a proper view of relationship so that we can hit the target we're aiming for. Hebrews 12, verse 2, it says that we look to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus is both the founder and perfecter of our faith. We rely on him to be our foundation, and our relationships are based on him, and our relationships continually improve when he is our foundation. It does not mean it will be easy. After all, Jesus had to endure the cross, but it is so worth it. And Jesus is the center of marriage. Part of this Christian marriage is that it is, you know, a lot of times the world thinks marriage is a contract. It's a 50-50 kind of deal. But that's not really the deal here. This is a covenant, not a contract. Covenant is where you give your whole selves to each other, not just 50-50. Not only do you give yourselves wholly to each other, but to God in that action. A covenant is based on the foundation of God, has God involved. It's not just between two people, it's between you two and God. You both are accountable not only to each other, but to God, and primarily to God. And that is a difference. That is one of the differences between a contract and a covenant. And Christ is central to that relationship, to this relationship. So the marriage covenant relationship is something that Paul referred to in Ephesians 5, and he says that it is a profound mystery, this marriage thing. Awesome. And he refers that to Christ's relationship to his church, to the church. Jesus Christ loves his church and gave up himself for his church. And in many ways, you both will have to give up yourselves for the other. You are no longer, and I said this yesterday to you guys, but you are no longer just Maky. And you're no longer just Sophie. You are Maky and Sophie. You will be Maky and Sophie. You will both become one, and you will give up yourself for that new person. All right, so then that leads me to the second C. Don't worry, he'll get shorter as we go. Second C is communication. This is very important. So to have a good working marriage, you need communication. And as much as we like to think that we can read each other's minds, a lot of times we're mistaken in that. And we're always communicating to each other in our relationships, no matter what you're doing. We communicate by the ways we act around each other, the attitudes we have, all of those kinds of things. And of course, the main way we communicate is by talking to each other. And it's okay to talk to each other. It's good. Communicating your love for one another is so important. And it is a very important factor in your marriage. And we can look at God for this too. God communicated his love for each one of us through Jesus. John 3:16-17. It's classic, right? Most of us know this. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. This is beautiful because we see that God's intention for us was to love us. And it's not always easy to see that. A lot of times we will think the other person is out to get us or that kind of thing. Here we see God saying, no, I love you. In the same way, when you guys are talking with each other and communicating, you want to express your love for one another. God is not out to take advantage of us, but he is out to save us from our impossible situation. And what I love about this is that God actually got on our level by becoming human. You, Maky, will have to get on Sophie's level. I know that's hard because you have to go up. But you're going to have to get on her level to communicate your love for her and to her. And Sophie, you will have to get on Maky's level. I don't know what that is, if it's hunting or catching rattlesnakes and that kind of thing. But you're going to have to get on his level to be able to communicate your love to him. This isn't easy, especially when there's hang-ups in the relationship, when there's wrongdoing or there's things that happen where, you know, you have to forgive or you have to press in. But press in. Don't distance. Don't distance yourself from each other in those times. God did not distance himself from us. Don't distance yourselves from each other. You need to press in through communication. And the more you get to know each other as you communicate, the more vulnerable you will be to each other. And that can be scary as you know each other's flaws more and more. As you know each other better, it can be a scary thing. But because of love, love makes all of the difference. Just like God. Right? God knows us from our core. He knows us. He created us. He loves us, though. And that makes all the difference. If he didn't love us, we're scared. So press into that relationship just like God presses into the relationship with us. Even though we have our flaws, we can trust God and we can trust each other. We know that he loves us and wants what's best for us. So, this communication of vulnerability, trust, and love is reflected in a good marriage relationship. This communication, and I don't want to miss this, it's important, also involves physical intimacy. Holding hands, that's good. You can be affectionate towards one another. And it's a beautiful thing about love. You communicate it in so many different ways. Don't miss the physical aspects. God made you physical beings. That's okay. Embrace that. Okay. This leads me to the third C, which is community. When your marriage relationship is based on the foundation of Christ, and you have Christ-like communication that is vulnerable, trustworthy, and loving, it really it does create that sense of community amongst yourselves. It is attractive. It attracts others into that relationship. You desire to share your life with each other, and eventually it often increases with other people who want to be a part of that, and not only that, but even children, right? That closeness, that communication. This is reflective in how God desires to be with his creation, to restore that relationship so that we can be with him. It is all about the fact that God desires to be with us, and you desire to be with each other, which is awesome. Revelation 21, verses 2 and 3, refers to God's fulfillment of this, when his church will be united forever with him in total completeness. Don't worry about the rain. It says this, "And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Isn't that awesome? That this is the language that is used in the Bible of Christ and the church. No wonder we value so much. It says this, though. It continues in Revelation. It says, "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God." As you two have showed up here to come together and start a new community, together as you dwell with each other, it reflects and looks forward to God completing his work so that we can dwell with him forever in relationship. So you two will be dwelling with each other, and that is awesome. So, community. So to review, just remember the CCC, right? Christ, communication, and community. Christ is the covenant foundation where communication is allowed to flourish, which then creates community. Marriage is a reflection of the good news of Jesus Christ. Now, try to keep that short. All right, let's get on with this. I'm not sure what's better, stifling heat or a little bit of rain. Okay. So what we're going to do now, I'm going to just ask you some questions, and you say, I do, and then, and these are promises. These are things that you guys want to do, and you're looking to do these. So I'm going to do this, and I will start with you, Maky, and I will I'm going to ask you two questions. Do you, Micaiah Gleckner, take Sophia Shedden to be your wedded wife, to live together in marriage?
I do.
Do you promise to love her, comfort her, honor her, and keep her, for better or for worse, in sickness and in health, in joys and in sorrows, so long as you both shall live?
I do.
You, Shedden, take Micaiah Gleckner to be your wedded husband, to live together in marriage?
I do.
Do you promise to love him, comfort him, honor him, and keep him, for better or for worse, in sickness and in health, in joys and in sorrows, so long as you both shall live?
I do.
When Sophie first became interested in me, she told me that she was on the prowl after me, and she had a game plan of how she was gonna win me over. And that part of that involved liking one of my pictures a few days after I posted it to try to get me to notice her, and it worked. She caught my attention. She asked if I wanted to hang out one night, and I said yeah, and I went up and said I just hung out with her for the night, and I just saw how much I was very compatible with her, and I could just tell that she was kind and compassionate, and she had a great relationship with Jesus, which are very important things to me when I look for like qualities of a woman. And she definitely has a very genuine love for everybody. I can't say enough good things about her. And it didn't take me long to realize that God wanted me to marry her. And I love that she is so devoted, first to God, second to her family, friends, and me. And I love that she will go anywhere and do anything with me. For example, one of our first dates, I asked if she wanted to go catfishing with me, which, you know, might not seem like the most appealing thing, and we went and we ended up catching 10 catfish that night, and it was one of the best nights of my life. But I saw in that she was willing to do anything and go anywhere with me, and so I knew that she would just be a great wife, and she would always do that throughout all of our lives. So, with that being said, I have some things that I want to promise to you going into our marriage. I promise to always keep Jesus as the center of our marriage. I promise to always love you unconditionally. I promise to love you more and more every day. I promise to cherish you and to always try to make you feel loved and appreciated. I promise to appreciate that you are way out of my league. I promise you and I will follow what we feel like God's plan is for us. I promise to be a leader in our marriage. I promise to respect you and your opinions. I promise I will try my best to be a good husband and father when the time comes. And I will love you for better or for worse, in sickness and in health, as long as we both shall live until death do us part.
Mine aren't as good as Maky's work. Soon after we first met, I knew that Maky was the one for me, that God had. I love how compassionate and kind your heart is, how you truly care about other people's happiness, and how it deeply bothers you to see other people unhappy. I love how you're generous with your time and money. Most importantly, I love how you truly desire to serve God. I love how you always put my needs before yours. And I love how you always treat me the best that you can. Today, as you stand before God and man, I ask you, Maky Gleckner, to be my husband. I promise to serve you and to be faithful to you. I promise to be honest and open with you. I promise to respect you and trust you, to help and care for you. I promise to comfort, encourage, and to support you. I promise to help raise and guide our future family to become true followers of Christ in the best ability. I promise to be yours in plenty and in want, in sickness and in health. And I promise to share my life with you and love you all the days of my life. Do us part.
So now we're ready for the ring. So, Maky, I'm going to have you repeat after me, as we do this. It's real simple, okay? Actually, before I do that, I want to talk about the rings just a second. So, rings, they're round, right? Unending. You don't have a start or a beginning. I love that because it's kind of a picture of God's love for us, right? No beginning, no end. And you can think about how when God loves us and we love others, that's kind of love we have for one another. And so no beginning, no ending. It's also forged with a lot of heat, a lot of hard work to make these ring. And sometimes that's the way it is. Love, it takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of heat sometimes, but it's so worth it, and it's never ending. So remember that. And this is a symbol, so it's great. All right, repeat after me. I give you this ring.
I give you this ring.
As a symbol of my love and commitment.
As a symbol of my love and commitment.
All right, so, same for you. Alright, I give you this ring. As a symbol of my love and commitment.
As a symbol of my love and commitment.
So what I want to do next is I just want to pray a prayer of blessing to you guys. And so, like I said, God is involved in this, right? This is God doing this work, and this is a covenant. So we're going to pray and just ask for blessing. Father, you are glorious. You are too wonderful for comprehension. Recognize your majesty as you are currently ruling from your throne on high. And we recognize your sovereignty in bringing us all together today for this wonderful occasion. You and your perfect will have brought together Maky and Sophie to enter into a covenant relationship together with you as the center. I ask that you would bless their marriage. I ask that your power would be evidenced in their marriage by their deep love for one another. I ask that by your Holy Spirit, you would empower them to live out the life you have intended. You would continually look to Jesus as their Savior and their example of how to live out their marriage. I ask that they would live into the purpose that you have for their lives. Father, give them the grace, the mercy, and the love as they will dwell with each other in unity. We ask that your continual blessing poured out in their lives. And I ask these things in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. All right, Maky and Sophie. Read your vows of marriage in our presence and in the presence of God through Jesus Christ, along with the power given to me by the state of Pennsylvania. I now, in great joy, pronounce husband and wife. Maky, you may kiss your bride. Pleased to present to you Mr. and Mrs. Maky.